Chapter 11, To Have and To Hold. As usual, after the strawberry season was over in Santa Maria, Papa decided to move to the San Joaquin Valley in Central California to pick grapes. Like the year before, we had spent the summer months picking strawberries for Ito, the Japanese sharecropper. This time, however, we were not going to Fresno to harvest Mr. Sullivan's vineyards. Papa did not want us to live in Mr. Sullivan's old garage again. So we headed for Orosi, a small town a few miles southeast of Fresno. Papa had heard that a grape grower there named Mr. Patrini had nice places for farm workers to live. We packed our belongings and left Santa Maria in September, the week school started. Papa drove. Mama and Roberto sat in the front seat. My younger brothers, Trampita, Torito, and Ruben and I sat in the back. Rora, my little sister, slept on Mama's lap. Everyone was quiet. The only noise came from cars passing and the droning of the Carcachita's motor. As we passed by Main Street School, I reached underneath the front seat and pulled out my penny collection, which I kept in a small white cardboard box. I then felt my shirt pocket for my blue notepad. I took it out, placed it on the box, and held them both tightly in my hands as I stared out the window, wondering what Orosi would be like. After we had been traveling for a few miles, I put my notepad back in my shirt pocket, took the top off my coin box, and started looking at my pennies. I divided them into two layers, separated by cotton. On top were my two favorites, a 1910 Lincoln head and an 1865 Indian head. The 1910 Lincoln head penny had belonged to Papa, but he gave it to me. We were living in Delano, and every day after coming home from picking grapes, Papa took out his small metal box where he kept our savings and placed the day's earnings inside. One Sunday evening, when he emptied the box on the table to count the money, a penny rolled off and landed next to me. I picked it up and handed it to him. "Do you know how old this coin is?" he asked. "No," I said. "It was made in 1910, the year I was born," he said proudly. "It's a very old penny," Mama said, chuckling as she cooked supper on her kerosene stove. Papa glanced over at Mama, laughed, and replied, "It's only a couple of years older than you, Vea," holding it in his hand. Papa continued, "The revolution started that same year." "What revolution?" I asked. "The Mexican Revolution," he responded. "I don't know the whole story," he said apologetically. "I didn't go to school, but what I do know, I learned from listening to corridos and to your abuelita, Estefania. She told me that during that time, many of the rich hacendados treated the campesinos like slaves." "Did Abuelito Hilaro fight in the revolution?" I asked. "No, mijo. My father died 6 months after I was born. But your abuelita favored the revolution, just like all poor people did. I also heard that many hacendados buried their money and jewels in the ground to hide them from the revolutionaries. Many of those treasures have never been found, but they say that yellowish red flames shoot out from underneath the ground where the treasure is buried, and that you can see the blazes from far away at night." Then, with a twinkle in his eyes, he added, "I don't know if that's true, but that's what they say." Papa reached out, took my right hand, and placed the penny in it, saying, "You can have it. This way, you'll never forget year I was born. And if you keep on saving pennies, someday you'll have your own treasure." I was so excited I almost forgot to thank Papa. I examined the penny closely. The year 1910 was worn. That is when I started collecting pennies. I like the older ones best. As we made our way up the San Luis Obispo grade, I placed the Lincoln head penny back in the box and took out my 1865 Indian head coin. Carl had given it to me when I was in the fifth grade in Corcoran. He and I were good friends in school, and when we found out that we both collected coins, we became the best of friends. We made sure we got on each other's team when we played ball during recess, and we ate our lunch together every day. One Friday after school, Carl invited me to his home to see his coin collection. As soon as the last bell rang, we ran to his house, which was only 3 blocks away. When I walked in, I was amazed. I had never been inside a house before. The rug under my feet felt like a sack full of cotton. The living room was warm and as big as the one-room cabin we lived in. The light was soft and soothing. Carl then showed me his room. He had his own bed and his own desk. From the closet, which was half full of clothes, he pulled out a cigar box and several dark blue folders. "These are my pennies," he said, opening up one of the folders. His coins were all neatly organized by year. My eyes and fingers went straight to the oldest. "That's an 1860 Indian head," he said. "I thought all pennies were Lincoln heads," I said in surprise. "Oh no," he exclaimed, opening his cigar box. "See, I have lots of them." "I'll give you one of my Lincoln pennies for one of your Indian heads," I said. Carl thought about it for a while and then said, "You don't have to. I'll give you one. Pick the one you want." "Thanks," I said excitedly. I quickly went through the loose pennies in his box and picked one made in 1865. It was the oldest one I could find. On the way back to school to catch my bus, Carl said, "When can I come to your house and see your collection?" His question took me by surprise. I never thought he would want to visit me at our home. And after seeing his house, I was not sure I wanted him to see where I lived. "Well, when?" he asked again, looking a bit confused because I did not answer him. After thinking of possible excuses, I finally said, "I live too far. I'll bring my collection to school. It's not much, just a few Lincoln head pennies." "That's okay. I like to see it anyway," he said. I never got the chance to show Carl my collection. That weekend, we moved to 5 points, and I never saw my friend again. I placed the penny back in the box and closed it. I looked straight ahead through the windshield between Papa and Mama to see how far we have traveled, and to look for road signs to Orosi. "What does Orosi mean?" I asked Papa. "I'm not sure, mijo," he responded, "but I have a feeling we're going to like it there." I took out my notepad and wrote the word down, breaking it into 2 syllables. Orosi. Oro meant gold in Spanish, and si meant either yes or if. Based on what Papa said, I figured it meant yes in this case. I closed the notepad and held it in the palm of my hand. It was almost brand new when I found it in the city dump in Santa Maria. Now its blue soft covers were beginning to fade and its corners were frayed. As I smoothed them out with my fingers, I recalled when I first started to use it. I was in Miss Martin's 6th grade class in Santa Maria. It was the end of January, and we had just returned from Fresno, where I had started the 6th grade in Mr. Lima's class in November. I was behind in English, Miss Martin's favorite subject. Every day, she would write a different English word on the blackboard and ask the class to look it up in our dictionaries as fast as we could. The student who found the word the quickest would get a point, and at the end of the week, the one with the most points would get a gold star. I never got a gold star or a point. It took me too long to find the words, and I did not know what many of them meant. So I got the idea of writing the words down in my notepad, along with their definitions, and memorizing them. I did this for the rest of the year. And after I left Miss Martin's class, I continued adding new words and their definitions to my notepad. I also wrote other things I needed to learn for school and things I wanted to know by heart, like spelling words and math and grammar rules. I carried the notepad in my shirt pocket and while I worked in the fields, memorized the information I had written in it. I took my librito with me wherever I went. After traveling for about 5 hours, we arrived at our new home in Orosi. It was an old 2-story yellow wooden house. It was located about 15 miles outside the city limits. Mr. Petrini, the owner, told us that the house was 70 years old. We could not use the second level because the floors were unstable. The first floor had two rooms and a kitchen. Behind the house was a large barn and hundreds of vineyards. It did not take long to unload our car Cheetah and settle in. Papa, Mama, and Rora took one room. Roberto, Trampita, Torito, Ruben, and I moved into the other one. After my brothers and I had put away our few things, I sat on the floor and looked at my pennies. I wanted to make sure they were not rubbing against each other in the box before placing them underneath the mattress. When I looked up, Rora was standing next to me. "Can I have one?" "One what?" I asked. "A penny," she answered. "Not one of these," I said. "These are special." She made a face and walked away, stomping her tiny feet. That evening, before going to bed, I checked on my pennies again. I then took off my shirt and carefully hung it on a nail in the wall and made sure my notepad did not fall out of the pocket. After our prayers, we slipped into bed. I had trouble falling asleep. "I can't believe we are living in a house," I thought to myself. My little brothers must have been excited too, because they started whispering and giggling. Roberto tried to quiet them down, but they would not stop. "Listen," Roberto said in a loud whisper, "I hear La Llorona weeping upstairs." "I don't hear anything. You're just trying to scare us," Trampita answered. "No, I am not," Roberto responded. "Just be quiet, and you'll hear her." There was dead silence for the rest of the night. The next day, before sunrise, Papa, Roberto, Trampita, and I went to pick grapes for Mr. Petrini. Mama stayed home to take care of my little sister and brothers. I took my notepad with me. I wanted to learn some spelling rules while I worked, but I couldn't. The angry, blistering sun did not let me. By 10 o'clock, my shirt was soaking wet. I wiped my hands on my pants and carefully removed the notepad from my shirt pocket and took it to the carcachita and left it there. I did not want it to get dirty and wet. By the end of the day, my whole body was covered with dust from the vineyards. My arms and hands looked like they were made of clay. I scraped the muddy layer off them with the hook knife I used for cutting grapes. At sundown, when we got home, Mama and Rora drove to the store while Papa Roberto, Trampita, and I stripped to our underwear and bathed in the trough that was behind the house. After we got dressed, I placed the notepad in the pocket of my clean shirt. When Mama returned, I helped her with the groceries. "Did you get any pennies and change?" I asked. She looked in her purse and handed me one. It was made in 1939. "Can I have it?" "Of course, mijito," she answered. I went to our room to add it to my collection. I took out my coin box from underneath the mattress and removed the top. The first layer of white cotton was bare. "No, they have to be here," I thought to myself. I swiftly removed the cotton and checked the second layer. Nothing. My 1910 and 1865 pennies were gone. I rushed out of the room shouting, "My pennies! Someone took them!" When I got to the kitchen, Rora ran and hid behind Mama, who was standing by the stove preparing dinner. "Did you take my pennies?" I yelled at my sister. "If you did, give them back to me, or give them to me." Holding on to Mama's leg with her left arm, Rora extended her right hand and offered me two red gumballs. "I don't want your gum. I want my two pennies," I shouted. She dropped the gumballs and started whimpering. "Calm down, Panchito," Mama said, then looked down at my sister and said, "Mija, did you take Panchito's pennies?" Rora nodded sheepishly. "And what did you do with them?" Mama continued. Rora pointed to the gumballs on the floor. "Did you put the pennies in the gumball machine at the store?" she asked. When my sister nodded again, my heart dropped to my stomach. I felt my face on fire, everything blurred. I stormed out of the house, slammed the door behind me, sat on the front stairs, and cried. Seconds later, Mama came out and sat beside me. "I know how disappointed you are, mijito, but your sister's only 4 years old," she said tenderly. Then, clearing her throat, she continued, "Let me tell you a story I heard when I was a little girl. Long ago, there lived a very smart ant who saved her pennies for so many years that she became rich. Many animals wanted to marry her, but they frightened her. The cat mewed too much, the parrot talked too much, and the dog barked too loud. A bull and a goat also scared her, but not a little brown mouse named El Ratoncito. He was quiet, intelligent, polite, and mannerly. They got married and lived happily for a very long time. But one day, when the ant was cooking a pot of beans, she fell in it and drowned, leaving El Ratoncito with a lot of pennies, but terribly sad and lonely. So, you see, mijito, Rora is more important than the pennies. Don't be so hard on your little sister. Mama's story calmed me down a little, but I was still angry at Rora. I took a deep breath and went back inside to our room. I sat on the mattress and pulled out my notepad from my shirt pocket. I turned to the page where I listed my pennies and crossed off the Lincoln Head, 1910, and the Indian Head, 1865. The following morning, before going to work, Mama and I covered my notepad with wax paper to keep it clean. I then marked the spelling rules I wanted to memorize that day. As I picked grapes, I went over them in my mind, looking at my notes only when I had to. This made the time go by faster. On our way home from work, we stopped at a gas station to get kerosene for our stove. The attendant filled our 5-gallon tank and placed it in the trunk of the car Kachita. When we arrived home, Papa gave Roberto the car keys and asked us to unload the tank and refill the stove with it. Panchito, this does not smell like kerosene, Roberto said as he took out the tank from the trunk. It smells like gasoline. You'd better go tell Papa. I went inside and told Papa. He was nailing a wall board that had come loose in our room. I am sure it's fine, mijo. It's probably cheap kerosene, he answered as he continued hammering. I took off my shirt, placed it on the mattress, and went back outside. Papa said it's okay, I told Roberto. He shrugged his shoulders, picked up the tank, and carried it to the kitchen. Mama was getting ready to cook dinner. She cleared the stove to make it easier for Roberto to refill it. The stove sat on a small table beneath a window that had plastic curtains. When Roberto was finished, Mama placed a pot of beans on one of the burners. Mm. She then lit a match. As soon as she touched it to the burner, the stove burst into flames, setting the curtains on fire. Ay, Dios míos, Mama exclaimed, pushing Roberto and me away from the stove. Vijo, the kitchen is on fire, she yelled. I was terrified. The plastic curtains curled up. Pieces of melted plastic fell to the floor, giving off dark smoke that smelled like burned rubber. Roberto picked up the dishpan full of soapy water and hurled it over the stove. It made the fire worse. Like thirsty tongues, the flames chased the water as it ran and spread on the floor. Get out, Papa shouted as he rushed in the kitchen and saw the flames. Out, out, he repeated. Mama, Roberto, and I ran to the front of the house. Trampita, Ruben, Rora, and Torito were already outside. We all stood by the carcachita. When I saw Mama sobbing, I felt more scared. A few minutes later, Papa came out, coughing and clenching in his arms something wrapped in a blanket. His hair was singed. He placed the bundle on the ground and uncovered it. The instant I saw the silver metal box, I thought of my notepad. Mi librito, I screamed out, recalling that I had left it in my shirt on the mattress. I dashed toward the house, but Roberto quickly caught up to me and grabbed me by the back of the t-shirt and yelled, Are you crazy? I have to save it, I cried out, pulling away from him. Papa hurried over and stood in front of me. Ya, no seas tanto, Pancho, he shouted angrily. His glare frightened me. I stopped struggling to get away. Roberto let go of me. I clenched my fists and tried to hold back my tears. By the time the firemen came, the house had burned down completely. The dying flames looked like they were coming from under the ground. Papa picked up our savings box, started walking toward the barn, and said wearily, Let's stay in the barn tonight. Tomorrow we will look for another place. Everyone followed him except me. I stayed behind. Come on, Panchito, Mama said. When she saw I was not moving, she came up to me and placed her arm around me. I burst out crying, lifting my chin with her right hand and looking at me straight in the eyes. Mama said, We're safe and we have each other. Gracias a Dios. Yes, but what about my librito? It's gone, just like my pennies, I responded. After a long pause, she said, Do you know what was in your librito? Yes, I answered, wondering why she asked. Well, if you know what was in your librito, then it's not all lost. I heard Mama's words but did not understand what she meant until a few days later. We had moved to a labor camp also owned by Mr. Petrini and were picking grapes again. It was a scorching hot day. My clothes were drenched in sweat. I crouched underneath the vines for shade, but the heat pierced right through. I recalled the fire and placed my right hand over my shirt pocket. It was empty. Feeling a lump in my throat, I started thinking about Carl, my pennies, the house. Then, for a long time, I thought about my librito and what Mama said. I could see in my mind every word, every number, every rule I had written in my notepad. I knew everything in it by heart. Mama was right. It was not all lost.